Okay, good morning, everyone, and welcome to, I guess, the last of the summer services, because we're going to transition back to normal, whatever, the new normal. We have several announcements, and we also hope that everybody is receiving Hot Topics weekly. If not, let the church office know so that they can clue you in on stuff. Welcome to anybody who's visiting with us today. I'm not sure. I don't always know who's a visitor and who's just a regular drop-in person. I'm Ann Perrone, and as I said to the rest of the crew, I'm driving the bus today. So welcome aboard. I like to remind people, especially as we transition into fall and people might have more reasons to come to the church building for various reasons. If you're coming to the church for church business, please enter through the church office. Michael Yancey is there, and he will check everybody in and make sure that you sign in properly and get your temperature taken and whatnot. I believe Kara wants to say something about Adult Academy. So unmute yourself, Kara.
Okay. Well, good morning. And with the urging of last Sunday's coffee group, Adult Academy will be starting at 9:30 next week.
9:30 or 9:45?
9:30.
9:30. Okay.
Well, with the coffee break at 10:30, mm-hmm. We'll hope that that'll work.
Okay.
But last year we showed the video of Combatants for Peace, and we're all upset by the horrors of the Israeli and Palestinian conflict. But we're given hope by the combatants on both sides coming together to say enough is enough. I learned about this from Maynard Seidner, who is a fellow tutor at Houston Elementary School, who is coordinator of the Philadelphia Friends of Combatants for Peace. He and his wife, Sheila Weinberg, who's a rabbi, were scheduled to speak at Adult Academy when COVID hit. And I think this will be an informative and memorable presentation. So please sign on at 9:30, and the link will then continue for the coffee clutch and the service. And I hope to see you then.
Thanks, Kara. A couple of other things that I gleaned from Hot Topics. Tuesday the 15th is another food distribution day. And we'd like to have any volunteers who are there to help unload the truck and put in maybe a few last minute items into the boxes and then hand them out as people come by. It works best if we've got 6 or 7 or 8 people who can cover both sides of the street and take care of moving things around. I will again ask the scouts to be there. And so please be there at 9 if you're going to help out, because the folks start coming at 10 and there's some work to do. Barb, did I miss anything? Is Barb on today?
Yeah, I'm here, yes. And I did just want to say that I think last month I really enjoyed myself. It was great working with United Methodist Neighborhood Services, and we all were, and the scouts. I mean, everyone loved the scouts. And it was really neat to see that. And I think especially, if I can just put a word in with the scouts, that people in our neighborhood are looking for places to send their young men and women for scouts.
Oh, yeah.
And I think it's when we can talk about collaboration with the needs of the community, and especially during these times, really all times, doing food distribution. That's really a thing that draws people out, because, you know, it comes from the heart and it doesn't come from the head. And it's a very easy thing to do. And the process, I thought, really went by quickly. And I know at least those of us that were handing out the boxes, as well as those that were receiving them, most of us were in masks. We were all wearing our face mask, if not the majority. So I hope you can make it on Tuesday the 15th at 9. Love to see you there.
All right, and Lucy and David Hill are also collecting food donations. They've got this convenient thing where you can just drop food off on their porch. They'll have a box or bags or some kind of designated area ready by Saturday, September the 12th. And then those donations will be delivered to a different place. These are two separate food drives on Tuesday, September the 15th. So reach out to Lucy and David if you need their address or ask the church office. Okie dokie. Bob, you had an announcement. You're all by yourself in the church.
You got that one?
Mm-hmm.
Good morning, everyone. I just want to share with you that this past week, the Thompson family moved from Fumcog to Tabernacle United Church in West Philadelphia for the first time in 2 years. I'm in the church building on a Sunday morning, fully alone. So just want to share that. Our prayers go with them. The ultimate goal, they're still in sanctuary. That means they're still under the watchful eye of ICE. And our prayer is for their freedom to become permanent residents of the United States. So their struggle continues. Just now they're in another place. And I thank you all for the generosity this congregation has shown over these past 2 years. We can say that the families that sought shelter here are in different places now. One is free and the other is in another place where they will be loved and accepted and resourced towards their freedom as well. I'm not saying I'm lonely here by any means, but it sure is quiet and nice to be able to begin to restore what we need to restore here. So thank you for your generosity in hosting, in offering the sanctuary. And we still consider ourselves a sanctuary church.
All righty. Let me see what I gotta do here. Okay. Bible study will be this Wednesday at 3, not at their usual time. And Gabe, do you want to say something about Zoom coming?
Sure. This is just a way for anyone who wants to join us this Tuesday, September 8th at 2 p.m. or Thursday, if Tuesday doesn't work for you, September 10th at 11 a.m. It's just a way to catch up with each other, see how we're doing. I know that because of the pandemic, it's difficult for us to physically see each other and to catch up. But join us if you just want to come out and chat with other Fumcoggers and see what everyone's been up to this summer. So that's what that'll be on Tuesday and Thursday.
Okay. And unless anybody else has any others, our reminder that next week is Homecoming Sunday. We go back to 11 a.m. worship. I need to change this slide, but I didn't have time. Adult Academy will begin at 9:30 so that they can have a full hour, and then the coffee half hour will begin at 10:30 and the worship will begin at 11. So maybe bring breakfast and lunch. I don't know. But at any rate, keep watching. And as I mentioned before, if you're not getting hot topics, please let somebody know, or maybe put something in the chat so that we can make sure that you're getting that, because that's where all the details are about all of these things. Okay. All righty. Let us begin with our acknowledgments.
As a faith congregation, we acknowledge that this is a pivotal moment in American history. and that our mission is clearly laid out in the gospel of Jesus. We acknowledge our mission to seek justice for Black and Brown people of all genders and orientations, dismantle systems of bias and racism, call out those who protect the power of state-sponsored violence against Black and Brown bodies, and recenter the voices of the marginalized of our community and society. We acknowledge our part perpetuating white norms of language, style, worship, behavior, and culture. And with the guidance of the Holy Spirit, we acknowledge the truth that Black lives matter. We acknowledge that the service of worship is being held on the traditional lands of the Lenni Lenape people, and we pay respect to elders past and present. We affirm the sacredness of Native people, their languages, their cultures, and their gifts to the church and the world.
in the love that makes and holds all things welcome.
God's peace be yours.
We join friends to share a story of a meal.
Meals are so common, so ordinary.
This, though, is the tale of a feast.
Feasts are more interesting.
This is the tale of a feast where everyone eats their fill.
No skimping, no cutting portions, plenty for all.
This is a feast where everyone eats their fill in the midst of scarcity.
But how can that be?
This is the tale of one who gives and calls for abundance.
So that everyone has enough? Is that even possible?
In the grace of a bountiful God, all things are possible.
Then we join not only to hear a tale, but to join our hearts in praise. Alleluia, alleluia. What if there is not enough? What if we run out? What if the bottom falls out and we need so much more? What if things change? What if they do not?
What if something goes wrong or someone cheats us?
We have learned so well, O God, to ask what if. But you say to us, if only you would let go of fear.
If only you would learn to trust.
If only you would be glad with enough. If only you would share more freely.
Give more readily. Receive more gracefully.
If only, then my kingdom would come.
Thy will be done on earth.
So you speak to us, O God. This day, let us hear.
This day, let our hearts be released from worry. This day, let us rest in your promise and rise in your call. Amen.
God of unchangeable power, when you fashioned the world, the morning stars sang together, and the host of heaven shouted for joy. Let us join in this song of glory and be a source of kindness and peace for all creation. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Please feel free to unmute yourselves as you go to your breakout rooms and greet one another.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Phyllis.
Good morning, Gloria. Gabe, Tom.
Good morning. How's it going?
A beautiful day out there in the neighborhood.
It is.
Gabe, are you still cloistered? Is that still part of the retreat? Maybe it's just the same background. See him from prior week.
It sounds like you're underwater, Tom.
It's a work Zoom. It's part of the problem.
It's a waterfall.
I think you were saying something about my background, though, right? If I understood correctly, this is
yes.
Yeah, this is the Garden of Gethsemane. So in Israel, so that's why I still have it up.
It's a good
reminder for me.
Very serene.
Yes.
Very peaceful looking.
Yes.
When was the picture taken?
I actually don't know. This is I just Googled it and added it.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But I have been there.
Maybe you visited.
I have been there. I went there when I was.
You must visit. You must visit soon.
I went there when I was young. I was a teenager. I was 17 when I went to Israel. So it was a good experience.
Okay. So you've been to Israel.
I haven't.
Okay.
It's an interesting country.
Great. Yeah.
I saw a lot of. Soldiers with AR's, and it was crazy to think about the contrast of all of its history and to see that with it. But it, overall, it was a good experience.
Yeah. Okay.
Go again.
I'm sorry.
I have to go back to Israel again.
Yeah. Yeah, that'd be nice. Phyllis, you doing okay?
Yeah, I'm doing great. Thank you.
I did hear your you mentioned about Linda, and I've been thinking a lot about her and her sister and her mother.
I don't know if we need myself.
Hey, Phyllis. What's cooking?
She's muted.
Let me know when everybody's back.
Okay, we're back now. Are we muted again?
Not yet.
No, I think they mute us.
Okay.
I don't know.
Hey, Dave.
See, Phyllis is muted. She's got a line through hers. This is ours, and the line's not through it. If I click it, it'll mute.
Okay, Jody, can you mute everybody? I'm going to go back to the screen.
We start today with a reading from Psalms, Psalm 86, the first 13 verses. Incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am devoted to you. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all day long. Gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving and abounding in steadfast love to all who call on you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my cry of supplication. In the day of my trouble, I call on you, for you will answer me. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and bow down before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love towards me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. We follow this with a contemporary reading from Ted Loader's book, Guerrillas of Grace, Prayers for the Battle. This poem is entitled, Let Wonder Have Its Way With Me. O God, your gracious spirit moves over the mysteries of living and dying and is strangely present to me in the falling leaves, the call of the wild geese, a child's birth, the light in a friend's eyes, the sudden lifting of the heart, the deep longing which brings me to you now. Make me aware of your presence, that wonder may have its way with me, my passion be released, my confidence renewed in the depths of your holiness, until for a moment, my longing for you be fulfilled, and I know I am really free to share bread and intimacy, to laugh and exchange mercy, to be at ease in my struggles, bold in my loving, brave in facing down my terror, hopeful in the rising music of your kingdom, joyful in my living, and graceful in my life, becoming a song of praise ever sung to you.
And there's no sound.
I don't know what you're saying.
It looks like we're just going to go ahead with this scripture reading. As you can tell by the pictures, I Wonder As I Wonder was to be sung. Maybe we hummed it along in the silence. But our scripture this morning is from the book of Acts, the third chapter, beginning with the first verse. One day Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer at 3:00 in the afternoon. And a man, lame from birth, was being carried in. People would lay him daily at the gate of the temple, called the Beautiful Gate, so that he could ask for alms from those entering the temple. When he saw Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked them for alms. Peter looked intently at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. Peter said, "I have no silver or gold, but what I have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stand up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up. And immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. Jumping up, he stood and began to walk. And he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. All the people saw him walking and praising God, and they recognized him as the one who used to sit and ask for alms at the Beautiful Gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him. I have another reading. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. When the blazing sun is gone, when he nothing shines upon, then you show your little light, twinkle, twinkle, all the night. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Then the traveler in the dark thanks you for your tiny spark. He could not see which way to go if you did not twinkle so. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. In the dark blue sky you keep, and often through my curtains peep, and you never shut your eye till the sun is in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. As your bright and tiny spark lights the traveler in the dark, though I know not what you are, twinkle, twinkle, little star. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. This past April, as we were urged to quarantine in place, Kirkridge Retreat Center found a way to to offer a program over Zoom. And they offered a program, a Circle of Trust program, on Wonder at Home. For some reason I have yet justified, I was intimidated by the thought of confronting my wondering. Given the context of a spreading virus, the need to be separated from my children, grandchildren, and people in Phuncog, I thought this was a chance to experience wonder in it all. See, I always associated wonder with children. You know, when children come into the world, everything is new to them. The child learns through experience and what the child hears. Children have such an inquisitive mind, observing, asking questions. What does it mean? How did you do that? Where are we going? Why are we going there? It comes naturally to the child because the child doesn't have the memories or the experiences to draw upon. Children are so innocent when they ask questions or experience something for the first time. Oh, how their innocence is such a gift. There is a shock, an awareness, and a sense of joy in a child's face when you see them discover something new, when they do something right, when they accomplish something and they finish it. Their innocence before they realize their vulnerability. So we watch out for them to keep them safe, to accept the responsibility for what they are to learn from us, oh, not just by what we teach them, but also from how they see us and what they see us do. The retreat used material by Kevin Eikenberry, who quotes Francis Bacon's writing, his observation that wonder is a seed of knowledge. My hesitancy to make this, I call it a retreat, was that I saw wonder as innocence rather than as discipline. To a child, it comes naturally. But when we lose our innocence, we are tempted by our desire for certainty. Certainty doesn't ask questions, it makes pronouncements. It's not about discovering faith, it is about believing in set dogma and doing things out of tradition. It's about translating script as it has been taught to us, not discovering how the scripture speaks to us in our time and in our context. In my pondering and thinking coming out of the retreat, I wrote a note to myself. As individuals, most of us move through our day focused on our task list, which leaves few chances for us to find or even notice the things that might bring us wonder. Yet we admire children for their vast ability to learn quickly. When making that comparison, consider who has the most wonder. The children's spirit of wonder or our adult spirit of wonder or lack thereof? Who has the most curiosity? And who lives in awe? You or the children? Kevin Eikenberry addresses wonder by inviting us to ponder and to ask questions of ourselves and of others. Pondering is related to asking questions and listening. Do we ever take the time just to ponder? I have come to practice wonder as a discipline. It's been a long time since I focused on or considered what it is to wonder. I thought it just came naturally. On some of my evening walks around the neighborhood, which includes both sides of Lincoln Drive, I tried to pay attention to what is happening around me. Seeing all kinds of birds flying around looking for food, finding something than flying off to a tree or a bush. I learned that these birds are city birds because they're not afraid of people. You can walk up pretty close to them before they fly away. And they don't fly away where you can't see them. They just fly away to move out of your way, just far enough that the passerby isn't a threat to them. When I saw them fly into a tree with something in their beak, I assumed that there was a nest in that tree. They considered home. I wondered if they ever forgot which tree was theirs and fly into the wrong tree. If they got lost and had to fly from tree to tree to find their nest. I would see them on the sidewalk ahead of me, and as I got closer, they would suddenly fly into the cyclone fence right there on the side of the walk. How did that little bird fly so fast into that little hole, diamond hole in a cyclone fence and land on that thin wire without rocking back and forth? Do the birds ever fly into each other and fall from the sky? The squirrels offer their own talents as well. Running, making a series of long jumps across the road, and with slowing down, go under the fence in a hole you never saw and never would consider a hole. I wonder too about squirrels. Do they ever go to the wrong tree? Do they ever forget where they buried the nuts? Do they ever fall off the power lines they use as highways to get from one place to the other? And what about those tiny bugs, the ones that aren't even as high as a crevice in the concrete walk that they crawl along? What does the world look like to them? Why are they there? And even they are part of the ecological system. These questions, in response to the question that initiates our sense of wonder. How do I ask questions about my surroundings? How often do I notice a sense of wonder in my life? Neil Burton, MD, in an article, A Study of Wonder in Psychology Today, writes, "Wonder is most similar to awe, but awe is more explicitly directed as something that is much greater or stronger than ourselves. Compared to wonder, awe is more closely associated with fear, reverence, or veneration than with joy. Without this element of respect and reverence, all that remains of awe is fear. That is no longer awe, but terror or horror. Awe is also less detached from wonder, which allows for greater and freer contemplation of its object. Wonder is a complex emotion involving elements of surprise, curiosity, contemplation, and joy. It is perhaps best defined as a heightened state of consciousness and emotion brought about by something singularly beautiful, rare, or unexpected. That is, by marvel." Dr. Burton brings us closer to the text of the book of Acts before us. A man, lame from birth, was being carried to the gate of the temple at the hour of prayer. People knew this man. He was there every day. All his life, he was there. And they carried him to the gate of the temple because they knew this man was poor. And every day he was at the gate called Beautiful. And every day he sat there and begged. And the people supported him in the giving, in the placing of him, and the moving him where he needed to be. This one day, John and Peter were coming to the temple to pray with all the others. The man asked John and Peter for alms. Peter said, "Look at us. I have no silver or gold, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stand up and walk." Peter took him by the right hand and pulled him up. Immediately, his feet and his ankles were strong. Not only did he just stand up, jumping up, he stood and began to walk. And as he entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God, the people in the temple saw this man. They knew as one who was a beggar sitting at the gate, lame from birth. Feeling hopeless, what they could do for him except to carry him into the gate where he could ask for alms. Never having been able to walk his whole life until now, they were filled with wonder and amazement at what happened to him, what they saw, what they experienced, what difference did it make. This is where wonder and awe meet. There is surprise, curiosity, contemplation, and joy, all in that moment. It was such a great moment that we are reading about it today. That story has been passed on for generations and generations, for millennial and millennial. That story was filled with such wonder and awe that it's part of our script today, a testimony to the wonder of God. And for the awe, for what they saw, the liberation this man was given. His whole life was transformed. The life of the community was transformed. No longer did they have someone who was poor having to beg every day for their sustenance. They had a person who participated fully in the life of the community. I invite you to reflect on the wonder you have experienced in your life. And as we share the bread and cup of communion this morning, the wonder that as we are apart, separated intentionally for the health of one another, yet together around this table of love and grace and peace. I talked to an Episcopalian friend of mine some months ago when this all started. And we talked about how we do communion. And I told him how we do it. He says, that wouldn't work for us. But in our context, in our place, in what we have, I believe the wonder of God will cover even the liturgy that we're used to saying, but find a way to share the uniqueness of this experience. And how being apart, we're together as one, breaking the bread together, sharing from the same cup. I want to share another poem from a familiar song by Peter, Paul, and Mary. So the bookends are Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star, How I Wonder What You Are. And hear the story, Puff the Magic Dragon. Lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Hanalei. Little Jackie Paper loved that rascal Puff and brought him strings and sealing wax and other fancy stuff. Oh, Puff the Magic Dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Hanalei. Puff the Magic Dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Hanalei. Together they would travel on a boat with billowed sail. Jackie kept a lookout perched on Puff's gigantic tail. Noble kings and princes would bow whene'er they came. Pirate ships would lower their flags when Puff roared out his name. Oh, Puff, the magic dragon, lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Hanalei. Puff the Magic Dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Hanalei. A dragon lives forever, but not so little boys. Painted wings and giant's rings make way for other toys. One gray night it happened, Jackie Paper came no more, and Puff that mighty dragon, he ceased his fearless roar. His head was bent in sorrow, green scales fell like rain. Puff no longer went to play along the cherry lane. Without his lifelong friend, Puff could not be brave. So Puff that mighty dragon sadly slipped into his grave. That make that cave. Oh, Puff the magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Hanalei. See, Puff, the dragon, the magic dragon, was created by a child's imagination. Puff was filled with wonder, the wonder the child created. And they came from the wonder that the child felt. We are told of their friendship, their travels, their strength, the impact they made on others, even pirates and princes and kings, that they experienced together. But then we come to the verse. A dragon lives forever, but not so little boys. Painted wings and giant rings make ways for other toys. One gray night it happened. Jackie Paper came no more. And Puff that mighty dragon, he ceased his fearless roar. His head was bent in sorrow. Puff no longer went to play along Cherry Lane. He no longer had his lifelong friend. So Puff the magic dragon sadly slipped into his cave. It was the wonder of a little boy who created Puff. As he grew up and his life changed, the innocent of childhood wonder was gone. Our faith journeys have been a part of our lives in many ways, through many and various experiences that help shape our faith and beliefs. Our questions aren't as innocent as they once were, but as long as we ask the questions on our journeys and practice the discipline to look on the world with wonder, we just may encounter the surprise and transformation that fills us with awe. This is not an awe to be feared. We worship a God that is not to be feared, but held in awe and wonderment. For the wonder is the beginning of wisdom. May we practice the discipline of wondering and pondering, for who knows what will come out of that. But like the people in the temple that day when the lame man was healed, we just might find surprise and hope and life and grace and be embraced by a God whose wonder fills us all. Our hymn is Wonderful Words of Life.
Thank you.
Friends, we have heard the good news. We have a wonderful God. Where have you seen wonder in your life? Let us give thanks for the ways that wonder and awe take us by surprise. Let us express our gratitude through our thoughts and prayers, through our offerings and tithes, through volunteering our time. Thanks be to God for God's wonder. Let us pray. O God in Christ, you have chosen us to be your friends and to know your will in the world. Therefore, we pray in Jesus' name that these tithes and offerings spread your love near and far. Amen.
Thank you.
Thanks for recovering that anthem. Wonderful. Let us join responsibly in the prayer of thanksgiving as we prepare for communion. God is with you.
And also with you.
Open your hearts.
We open them to God and to one another.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing to praise you, O God. You are the God of our beginnings and our end, the God who breathes us into life and receives us when our breath runs out, the God who weaves us into the web of all life and holds us always. You surround us with the grace of your creation and move us to create, to care, to work for shalom. So with your people on earth and with all the company of heaven, with all of creation itself, we praise your name.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and grace, creation pulses with your glory. Blessed are all who share your breath. Hosanna in all the earth.
Holy are you, O God, and blessed is your Christ, Jesus, in whom we learn what it is to be alive, open to your spirit in our depths and to your presence in everyone we meet. He welcomed those not welcome anywhere else and prayed even for his enemies. He fed those without food and healed those broken in body and spirit. In his life, we glimpse your work among us and what our lives most truly could be. He finally paid the price of standing with those who were broken or rejected. But first, he gathered with his disciples to share a meal. He took bread, blessing it, breaking it, and giving it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." When the meal was over, he took the cup, again blessing it and giving it to them, saying, "All of you, drink from this. This cup seals God's new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me." Now, in remembrance of your presence and work in Jesus, we offer our thanks and we give ourselves to continue what he began until all share in the fullness of life, even as now we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ dying destroyed our death. Christ rising restored our life. Christ coming anew opens the future.
Pour out your spirit on us and on the bread and the cup we bring. Feed us on your spirit of shalom that we may be Christ's body knit together by your love at work for all your world. By your spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until the fullness of your love fills a world finally healed and we feast together at your unending banquet. With all creation, we await that fullness and give ourselves to the work of its appearing, even as we praise your name.
Alleluia. Amen.
Let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Take the bread, the body of Christ, broken for you. Take the cup. The cup of God's love poured out for you. Let us pray. You knit us into a living body, O God, and free us by your presence. You love us and call us to love each other and every other. We give you thanks. even as we ask you to send us in your spirit to be bread and wine in a world in need of love in Christ. Amen. Spiritual disciplines, in our prayers, in our imaginations, especially in this time when peace is so needed, peace even within ourselves and within our communities, within this country, within our world. May it be a peace that passes all understanding. And as such, may that peace come out of our wonderings, what we hope for, what we yearn for, where our imaginations lead us to the possibilities that are filled with surprise and joy and not even understanding, but just delight for the experience that they bring. May the peace of Christ be with us all. Amen.